Around 60 participants have joined. I think let us begin the workshop today. I think we can start. So I welcome all the participants on the fourth day of this workshop on AI and applications. We are really having some very interesting sessions for the last 3 days, and I'm sure all of you are gaining as much as you can through the interactive sessions as well as during the presentation sessions. Today, we have two experts with us. The first speaker is Sri Amitabh Akuli. He will be speaking on AI in agriculture. And our second speaker today is Mrs. Munmun Chakraborty. She will be speaking on deep neural network architecture and learning with an application on facial recognition. So we have two lecture sessions today, and I would like to invite Mr. Amitabh Akuli as the first speaker. Now, before I request him to start his deliberation, I would like to give a brief introduction. He is a goal-oriented software developer. Mr. Amitabh Akuli received the ME degree in computer science and engineering from West Bengal University of Technology, Kolkata, India, in 2007. And he is pursuing his PhD in Jadavpur University. He is currently working as joint director in CDAC, Kolkata. His research interests include machine vision, sensors and sensing systems, process instrumentation, data analysis, and soft computing. He was actively involved in developing a number of instruments, InnoVision for quality monitoring of black tea, Annodarpan for quality estimation of rice, Resham Darshan for color characterization of silk yarn, Febrinoscope for detection of febrine disease in tussar moth, CT View, convectorized vision inspection unit for quality analysis of chili, Annodarpan Dynamic, that is miniature conveyorized multi-crop quality analysis system, E-Quality Veg. It is a system for quality assessment of vegetables, etc. He has applied for 10 patents, awarded with 4 patents, 10 software copyrights, and published more than 25 research papers in different journals, national and international conferences. I welcome Mr. Akuli, and I request him to please start his deliberation.
Thank you, madam, for introducing me. Now I'm sharing my screen. Can you view the screen?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir.
Okay, fine. So good morning to all of you. So this presentation describes the application of artificial intelligence in general and machine vision in particular in the area of agriculture. AI is described as the intelligent demonstration by a machine. More specifically, a machine that mimics the human perception of vision, hearing, touch, smell, and taste. The process involves gathering the signals through sensors like camera, microphone, tactile devices, and interpreting or extracting the knowledge from the signals. Extracting knowledge generally involves high level of mathematical computation. The technology is often termed as pattern matching, classification, object recognition, clustering, etc. So I'm going to focus on the area of application of AI particularly in machine vision technology in the agriculture. And I'll share my experience, what we have worked in CEDAC and develop applications or machineries that acts for monitoring of quality, process control, and instrumentation. So application of machine vision in agriculture is a broad area. First, we can categorize this broadly on quality estimation of food and agro produces. And our application basically focused on this area: disease detection, food processing sector, plant health monitoring, weed detection, grading and sorting of fruits and vegetables, GIS applications. But today, I'm going to tell more about on quality estimation of food and agro produces. And one application I'll share that is on disease detection, in particularly in resham moth. The name of the disease is pebdin. So quality is a complex perception of many attributes that are evaluated by a consumer subjectively. Like the human see an object first.
The voice is not coming.
Hello?
The voice was not coming for a few minutes. It's okay now.
Hello, is that okay?
Yes, yes. Okay now.
Okay. So quality is a complex perception of many attributes that are evaluated by a consumer subjectively. That perception mainly deals with the sight, smell, touch. And when our brain processes the information received by the senses and instantly compares or associates with our previous experience. And finally, we take a decision. Here, two things are important. One is acquiring the signal and comparing the signal with our past experience. So that is the intelligence portion. And if we apply this intelligence or adapt this intelligence portion to a machine, then our machine can able to distinguish or categorize the quality of a product. Main problem is the human beings that quality is a subjective measure. When human beings evaluate quality, it depends upon the experience, sex, age, biasness to the particular brand, then fatigueness. So quality may be varied to human to human. But when it comes to machine, it is more objective, gives you the more objective measures and give the more repeatable value. That is the advantage of machine application compared to the human beings. Physical components of quality attributes of food and agro mainly deals with the appearance, aroma, taste, and the hardness of a food. You can see in one example of that one, a degree of ripening of a tomato is basically measured by a change in color. When it is in immature stage, the color of a tomato is basically green. When it gets ripened, the color changes to red. Same example can be given for a capsicum, where the color changes from green to yellow. For the cherry, the color changes from brown color to a reddish color. So the ripening stage of any fruit product basically measured with a color change. That is one aspect. Another is the size. In case of immature fruit products, the size is small. And when it grows up, size increases. And when it gets an optimum condition, the maximum size obtained, after that, it is gets sharpened. So size and shape, also the surface property or texture is an important parameter for determination of quality of food. Coming to the electronic vision, basically we have a camera that acquires the image under controlled illumination. So we have developed the system that can acquire image, and we have placed the camera and illumination system within a closed cabinet so that it doesn't affect the external interference of light. The mechanical structure for camera holding we have developed, and a sample holding arrangement, different type of sample holders we have developed to handle the liquid sample, the solid sample. And the vision system is capable to detect the complex color, grain size, shape, texture. So we have developed a number of algorithms to analyze the color, size, shape, and texture features. Also, we have basically applied a different color matching and pattern matching algorithm to detect the optimum point or maturity point or ripened stage. And this is basically we are comparing with our store database color, comparing the matching of the store database. In the digital image processing, basically there are few blocks. After image acquisition, we use a camera. Sometimes we can use an X-ray machine, the ultrasound device, and other multispectral camera. But here, today, I'll focus only the image acquisition using a simple digital color camera. Then comes to the image enhancement. It is the process to enhance the quality of image so that we can process easily. Basically, you can see in the image, that is a blurred image, and using the contrast enhancement technique, we can increase the contrast. Segmentation, basically a process to remove the background from the object. Morphological process is basically erosion, dilution, and basically remove we can take a small portion, the thinning and thickening portion we can do. Next, we can do the feature extraction. From the image, useful features can be extracted. Maybe color feature, maybe size, shape, texture, and lot of some features we may also define for that. And from this feature, we need to extract the meaningful information. We can either correlate with the our objective information to the features. During the training of the system, we basically take the input features and correlate with the output features. And finally, when we'll put an unknown object, we'll try to find the information from that training and give the output results. Now, a few products that we have developed in SIDAC that includes the innovation system that is basically measures the quality of tea. The Resham Darshan system basically characterizes the silk yarn. The Pebble Spore disease detection solution we termed as a pebinoscope. The Annadarpan system is basically characterize the grain size and classify the different types of rice grain. CityView system basically characterize the chili quality. Also, we have developed the solution using X-ray analysis for the silk content estimation, and another point, dynamic system for multi-crop analysis. But due to time limitation, today I'm going to tell about innovation system, the another point system, Pebinospore solution, and I'll touch upon the CityView system and another point dynamic system. The basic building block of any electronic vision system is more or less same. We need a digital camera for image acquisition, and rest of the thing is done in the software in a PC. So image processing, then from this processed image, we extract the features and perform the analysis. From the analysis results, we we interpret the results and take the decisions. Finally, we present the information in a computer screen. In electronic vision system for quality analysis of T, that is innovation, we have a enclosed cabinet. Within enclosed cabinets, we have put a camera and illumination arrangement. And below the camera, with a certain distance, we used to put the different type of samples. Maybe a solid tea, means matte tea or granular tea dimension for analysis. Color for liquor analysis, we can put a tea liquor samples. And this camera, it can be attached to the computer. And the computer is loaded with the software that can able to analyze the image and gives you the results. The basic building block I have already told you, and this digital camera we are using, it is nothing but a simple web camera, because we had made this system affordable to the user, and simple LED based illumination system with controls circuitry we have developed for that one, and software with different type of software we have developed. I'll come in the latter during the application portion. Now, the application of electronic vision for quality analysis, we have developed a number of applications using the same hardware platform. I should tell is a platform because the same hardware platform with a different kind of software, we can make a different application that is useful for tea manufacturing industry. So first one, we have developed the color monitoring of tea during fermentation. I'll come the fermentation in the next slides. Then the application of liquor color measurement, that is the mimicking the perception of tea tasters by taking the color of liquor, infused color, then brightness measurement, etc. Then finished tea grades, it is basically granular dimension estimation of the bulk tree. For each particle is measured, and the distribution of particle size is the output of the software. Then degree of blackness estimation and fiber content calculations. So this is the different softwares we have developed. In the tea processing, basically after plucking the tea leaf, it undergoes the process of withering. Then it goes the preconditioning process. Then the tea leaves are cut, tear, and curled using the CTC machine. After that, the process is called the fermentation, where our electronic vision system can be used. Finally, the process is called the drying, where the tea leaf enzymes are killed with a higher temperature. Then made tea is produced and it is marketed. And also before marketing, we need to check the quality. For that, we need to have an expert quality tester who evaluate the quality of tea using human perception. They check the appearance of the tea, then the smell of the tea, then the taste of the tea. And combining perception gives the output results. But in electronic visions, we are only concentrating on the appearance-based quality parameter. The quality aspect of finished tea are genetically present in the tea, and we cannot enhance. But after plucking of tea leaf due to bad processing, we can deteriorate the quality of tea. In tea fermentation, basically the fermentation time varying from 1 to 3 hours. So duration of time is very important, and our electronic vision system can detect the end point of fermentation and give the output in the duration of fermentation that is required for the optimum fermenting. And the fermentation process depends on the different type of clone, temperature, humidity, and withered leaf conditions. The end point of fermentation in industry just manually presently, either by observing the color during the fermentation process, the green color, you can see in the last portion of the slide, the green color turns into coppery brown when the fermentation end point of fermentations. And also in case of Darjeeling tea or other kind of tea, the odor is very important. Optimum point of fermentation is determined by checking the smell. But South Indian tea and North Tistia, Assam and Kenya and other parts of the country basically depends on the visual perception, that is the observing the color of the fermentation during the fermentation process. Under and over fermentation leading to the quality deteriorations, and during the taste by human beings, color may be defining the color may be a problem, because there may be a lot of subjectiveness may be there. And also the human evolution may not be repeatable. The conventional quality analysis technique involves for fermentation monitoring using the colorimetric testing, or sometimes the analytical chemistry method may be applied for that one. But the analytical chemistry method is time consuming, equipment is very costly, and high end equipment requires expert manpower for operations, and cumbersome sample preparation also time consuming. Colorimeter testing is an indirect method, and industry it is time consuming as well. And I told earlier that human testing is a subjective and may not be repeatable for all times. So there is a need for non-invasive, real-time, fast and low-cost methodologies for object quality estimation and electronic vision system. With that goal, we have developed this electronic vision system and different type of applications we have developed. And you can see the electronic vision system. It's a combined system. In right side, this is the electronic nose portion, and left side electronic vision system. And combining, we call this an innovation system, but today I'll only concentrating on the electronic vision part of it. During the fermentation monitoring, we developed a software. You can see the software screen in the left top corner, where we have created a number of image color that is called the color palette. This color palette is basically the various stages of color during fermentation we are stored in the database. And this color database is created automatically by the computer. For that, we need to take a huge number of images, and we have developed a software algorithm that compares the color of two different images, each to all images, and find out the difference. And if there is a minimum difference that can be distinguishable by a human beings, we have defined that color, and those colors are put into the database. And thus we have developed the color palette. During the testing, the fermentation color takes by the camera with a particular interval of time. Say for example, 1 minute or 5 minutes you can set in the computer. Computer takes the snaps automatically with a particular duration of type of the fermented leaf, try to match the color with the color template. And here you can see in a certain condition, it found some match with the color 12. During the fermentation, this color changes from 1 to 2 to 3 to 12, 14, 15, 16, and keeps on going. During the optimum fermentation time, by taking the expert view or the testing by a instrument analysis for the single time, we have to define the end point of fermentation. Remember, we need to define the fermentation end point of fermentation color with the help of tea expert for the single time. And once it is defined, then the total process is controlled by the computer throughout the day. And if there is a season change or tonal variation change, then again, we have to define the end point of color. As you can see in the image, or the screenshot, the end point of color has been defined with the 44. So during fermentation, color changes, and the color will change from one palette to another palette, and it will reach to the final color 44. And the computer raises an alarm either by in the form of color change or there is a sound alarm as well we have incorporated there. And this point, when color reaches this point, we have to stop the fermentation in the physical conditions and take the samples and put it to the dryer. So this is in a nutshell of electronic vision software for monitoring of fermentations. For development, we have developed the Visual C++ platform, and the database we have used the Microsoft Access and data analysis tool for different applications. It is not for the monitoring of that fermentation color of the tea liquor. For different other applications, we have also developed for biochemical parameter like theaflavin, theadubin analysis. We have used MATLAB software for analysis portion. And this software has been developed that can work in different platform of Windows. The software features, it has a graphical user interface option to set the target color. User can define its target, displaying duration of fermentation. The software displayed the duration of fermentation, the end point of fermentation. There is an alarm initiation process is there. Dynamic fermentation profile, you can see that it plots the color value with the time. And this is profile we have defined. This is very useful to control the fermentation process. Then data logging, then flexibility has been incorporated to the software to permit the tea planters themselves to train the system to build the color database for themselves. Now, basic image analysis steps involve, we are taking the image, 24-bit color image, BMP image using a webcam. Then we are converting the color image in the form of RGBA to hue, saturation, and intensity values, because the hue value basically define the human perception more accurately compared to the RGB color. Then plot of hue versus time represents the color profile. Hue-based color matching algorithm, the hue intersection algorithm we have implemented. Then individual marking from different analysis like liquor infusions we did with the same algorithm, hue intersection matching, color matching algorithm. And finally, individually, our software gives the score after checking the liquor color, liquor after adding the milk color, infusion color. Finally, combining these three parameters by using the weighted averaging method, we are getting the final T-tester-like score. Now, this is the hue histogram where we have a query image. And we have Q is basically a query image. M is basically matched value. And Q and M stands for this to a particular image. Query image, basically the testing T image under testing. And basically match value, this model image basically gives the database image or template images. And each bin is n bins. Say for example, you are using the hue values. So hue vary between 360 degree. So we have 360 degree bins, 360 bins there. Now, this algorithm is helpful for capable of indexing into large database, and match value is insensitive to the rotation and moderate changes in the distance. This is the two advantages. And for that, we are selecting this hue color, this hue histosection algorithm for that. I'm not going into the detail of histogram intersection. I'll share the slides, and it is very easy how we are calculating the histogram intersection. You can go through it. Now, the same histogram intersection algorithm we have used for matching of tea liquor color after adding milk, and the infused tea color. And as I told earlier, the weighted value of each analysis, this output gives the value 1 to 10 range, and weighted average value is we are getting the final t-tester like score. Now the granular dimensionality estimation and gradation of finished tea at dryer mouth, this is an important problem in the tea industry, where the dryer mouth, we are getting different particles of tea. But we want the uniform particle size, which is very difficult in the tea industry to produce the uniform size particle. But in tea industry, the tea testers used to measure the consistency of a particular tea grains within the bulk tree. Bulk tree means tea mixtures. So we have developed the software for analysis the particle size, and tea industry different size particle is termed as BOP, broken orange pico large, broken orange pico small, broken pico, pico dust, dust. And this has a specific range of size and it has been defined. So objective of this particular developing application to compute the consistency of different tea grades in the dryer output. And the same application can be applied during the tea testings or during the tea auction, where the tea samples need to be checked and percentage of different tea grades within the tree need to be analyzed. And this is the block diagram, how we did the develop the total solutions. Taking the digital image using a web camera. It's a, not a simple web camera, it's a high resolution web camera we have purchased from the market. It's commercially available. Then we converted the color image to the grayscale image. Then we enhanced the image using some algorithm. Then we removed the noise using median filtering technique. The background has been segmented using global threshold value. Age detection has been performed. Then we find out the contour. Then object counting has been done by component object labeling technology. Then each particle has been identified and area has been calculated, finding the number of pixels within the contour of a single object. Then based on the size of each particle, we are classifying different types of object as BP, BOP, PD, like this. Finally, we are calculating the percentage in the total image, the number of same type of object, and give the calculated value in percentage. So this is a software we have developed in Visual C++ platform. And right side is a result of a given event plot formation. During the fiber detection, fiber is basically the stalk portion that during the plucking of tea leaf, we are having some stalks, and these stalks forms the fiber portion. But if we'll find more fiber in a tea, that is not good for in point of view of the consumer, then the cost will deteriorate. So based on presence of fiber, the tea can be classified as a clean, fairly clean, means there is a minute fiber, trace and fibrous embedded, then fibrous tea, very, very fibrous tea. And we have identified the fiber in the same technology of particle analysis that I have described earlier, and finding the number of fiber component and different types of fibers, and doing the analysis of percentage calculations, we can able to classify the different type of tea based on presence of fiber. Now we have developed the system. This system is operational in 27 locations in India, and also one system is working in Kenya. We have applied for patents and software copyright. The technology has been commercialized. Now coming to the second application, it's about the system, the using the vision technology for quality analysis of rice. The name of the system, we have given the another one, smart. Now coming to the one use case of the system where we have deployed. In Food Corporation of India, they procured the rice sample. And after procurement, in the quality control lab, they need to check the 20 grams of rice sample. Before that, they need to sample this sampling technique they have used, taking a small sample from different bags, and they put together. And from this bag, this huge sample, they take only 20 grams of sample. This 20 grams of sample contains more than 1,600 to 2,000 number of tea grains, rice grains. And these rice grains need to be analyzed manually. And what are the parameters? this parameter and this I'm coming to the next slide, the parameter details, but before that, this quality control lab, we have successfully placed our another pond smart system, which the system can able to quality test the quality of rice grain instantly, reduce the human labor and time. In the rice industry, there are different parameters as per this AGMAR standard. These parameters are defined as the small grain, mean small broken, big broken, then the presence of red grain, discolored grain, damaged grain, chalky grain, that is basically milky white or white belly grain, then admixture of lower class, that is the rice grain, basically divided into two class. One is called grade A, another is common. And this particular grade A is common can be defined by calculating the length divided by breadth at middle portion of the rice. And this LEP weight ratio, if crosses 2.5, then we can term it is a grade A rice. If it is below 2.5, then it is called the common rice. Then the presence of foreign matter. So all these parameters can be evaluated using the another pond smart system within a few seconds. But in case of manual analysis, it takes more than 20 to 30 minutes for analyzing a single sample, rice sample. As I told you, the basic problem of manual analysis is subjective, time consuming, and laborious. And there is a need to develop a generalized solution. Why generalized? We have developed a single hardware platform. That platform not only analyzes the quality of rice grains, but using developing the different type of software, the solution can able to measure the quality of all different type of pulses as well. So this is a screenshot of another one smart system. Basic philosophy is same, but here we have used a scanner with high resolution because in the sub millimeter length, we need to measure. For that web camera that used in previous case where the color analysis is more important, stabilized color analysis is more important in previous case, but here the size is more important and resolution is an important factor. So we have used a scanner with a higher resolution. It is and features of the system is a portable system, USB scanning device under controlled illumination, then large sample handling tray, which can accommodate 20 grams of samples, 10 grams of sample in a single tray. But in industry, we need to put a two trays one after another and take the image and software accumulate these two samples calculations to arrive the results. Then the basic uniqueness of our developed solution is that we have developed a single hardware platform and multiple application to give the multiple solutions. So this is the uniqueness of our solutions and operated with the computer in Windows platform. Basically in the solution, we need to take the sample and manually we need to spread the sample on the sample tray. But remember, during the spreading of the sample should not overlap to each other, or if there is a touch, then image processing may not be able to correctly distinguish two sample. But if there is a small touch to the sample, our solution can able to separate these two samples. So this is the problem of this particular software we have developed. But in industry, the system solution is used for that. For that, we have made a sieving tray. In the sieving tray, we have put a various type of small holes where the rice sample is spread, and this spreading mechanism perfectly spread the rice sample so that the rice sample should not touch to each other. So this is the solutions we have developed, and our solution is able to take the image. From the image, it will help to extract the different features by calculating the particle area, is identified each grain, label each grain, identify the each grain area, perimeter, length, width. From the length width, it found the LB by ratio, that is basically calculating. I'll come to the latter slide, how we have done this. This is typically, the breadth calculation is typically difficult for rice, because the rice, the breadth is not uniform in throughout the length section of the rice. So we have adopt some different algorithm for that. I'll come to the latter slide regarding that one. So rice quality features, we have identified the foreign matter, then damaged grains, discolored grains, chalky grains, red grains, broken grain, admixture from that. These slides give you the overall, the image analysis steps, where we have taken the color image using the scanner, then find out the image cropping. This is basically the boundary portions we are eliminating when we are taking the image. There is a small portion, boundary portion is there. By image cropping, we take the middle portion of that one, and this eliminating the boundary portions. Obviously, during the design, we have taken care of that one. During the sieve design, the rice sample should not come into the boundary position. Then some median filtering technique we have used for noise removal. Then segmentation has been done using a fixed threshold. We have find out the global threshold, the OST2 algorithm for finding the threshold value for that one. Then edge detection technology has been adopted. Quick mux filter has been used for that one. Object label counting has been done, the same principle as that we have done in the previous during the particle analysis of tea. The dimensional and color feature extraction from each grains has been calculated. And finally, the quality parameter has been calculated from this dimensional and color analysis. And finally, we arrive the results and gives the result in terms of percentage of particular rice grains in the whole image. Area is basically the number of pixels inside the contour. So each number of pixels we are calculating simply, and this gives the area. Perimeter is nothing, the number of pixels in the contour. So length is the maximum distance between the two furthest point, and this distance between the Euclidean distance we have calculated for this maximum length calculations. For this average width calculations, we have segmented the rice grain through its length by 9 position. And from each positions, we draw the perpendicular depth, perpendicular to the length, and find out the each position, the size of the breadth, the calculating the breadth of that one. And finally, we find out the averaging of breadth, or as well as the RMS value, and as well as we are calculating the maximum breadth that is in the middle portion. So this middle portion is basically reflecting the breadth. We are not calculating the average breadth for this particular, but for this aspect ratio calculation and other calculations, different average value of breadth is very useful for that one. Different feature has been extracted from this grain length calculations. The aspect ratio of which is basically the minimum width to the maximum width. We have taken the 9 position, the width, and the minimum to the maximum, it's giving the aspect ratio. And this is very important feature for quality classification of rice. Then we have also calculated the safe factor, which is basically DRMSD. The formula is given below. That is the maximum D to the D minimum, then square. Then the root mean square calculation we have done for that one. Then D mean, basically we are calculating the width in all location, 9th location, then find out the average of that. Compactness ratio basically gives you the formula by 4 pi area by perimeter square. LB ratio basically length by width at middle locations. So these are the various features we have extracted. Using that features, we are able to classify the rice. Now the problem of this particular another cone system, as I told, the manual spreading. We have to take a sieve, manually we have to place the 20 grams of sample and you shake the sieve and rice grains are put in the union individual group. And finally, we are taking the image, and from the image, we are able to classify the rice grain. Hello?
Yes, sir, it is audible, sir.
Yeah. So now, for this manual to the fully automated system, we have developed a portable conveyorized system. So it's called the dynamic, another one dynamic system. You can see the system is basically a conveyor belt with a feeding arrangement. And on the hopper, we need to put a 20 grams of rice grains. And this particular spreader spreads the rice grain such that rice grain, when falling to the moving conveyor belt, it should not touch to each other. So it's a benchtop compact conveyor. It's a small size, around 3.5 feet size. We have developed and image acquisition system where we have put a scanner that we have used for this another one smart system. And there is an arrangement with that. The scanner scan the rice grain with a particular, when the particular comments come from the computer. And each grain, rice grain, one frame, it is taking. And in the background, they simultaneously analyze the rice grain. So the computer-based automated image capturing and analysis solutions we have developed. And each frame, the computer able to analyze the small broken, big broken, and other parameters. And finally, clubbing the all data, it's arrived the results, which is gives you the analysis results of 20 grams of grain sample. And when it found the frames without any sample, it checks the three frames. And if you find that there is no sample in consecutive three frames, software gives a command to stop the system, stop the conveyor belt, stop the image processing, image capturing process, and gives the results. So this particular process takes around 6 minutes to analyze 20 grams of rice sample. Now I have a video of that one. From the video, you can see how it is being done. So the total frames or total conveyor belt is partitioned into five groups. It's a particular frame, and when scanned, the frame is automatically scanned. And you can see one particular sensor that is red colored, and there is a strip. This is a metal strip is there, and this sensor identifies the presence of a strip. And with a particular delay time, it gives a command to the conveyor to stop the conveyor and gives the command to the image acquisition system to scan the image. So thus, it captures the frame and it stores the image to the computer. In backhand, the computer processes the each frames and gives the results. Now, the solution has been deployed. The 30 numbers of unit has been deployed in Food Corporation of India. The system is operational in their QC laboratories, also in the state government and APMCs. The system is running, up and running. And we have awarded with the patent and software copyright. And another pump system has been commercialized. This not another pump dynamic, the another pump system that was previously I have described to the commercialized. And the recipient is Nagarjuna Fertilizer Corporations. Now coming to the machine vision system for quality analysis of chili. I'll take only 10 minutes time to complete my presentation. In the quality parameters of chili, broadly classified as the color of chili, then length of the pod means, length of the pod means without the stalk, what is the length of the chili? Then the broken percentage of the chili, then the pod without stalk, foreign matter, discolored and damaged pod, loose seed. And there is the various types of, different types of parameter, the quality parameters I have shown, the broken chilies, the pod without stalk, deformed chilies, and foreign matter, etc. Now, coming to one use case, and in a you know that the electronic national agricultural market is now upcoming, where you can bid remotely or procure the sample remotely. But in the procurement, remote procurement, there is a problem of quality estimation. How can we measure the quality by sitting remotely? For that, we have developed this solution, and this solution is working in different APNC. There, they check the quality of samples using our solutions, and the quality parameters is uploaded directly to the INAM portal. It has a direct link to the INAM, where the quality parameter of chili samples is, you can see, and basically looking at the quality parameter, you can bid or you can give a particular price for a particular product. So this is very useful for remote procurement of chili sample. Now, during this technology, previously it was that presently it is manual intervention is there. Problem with manual analysis, it is subjective, time consuming and laborious, and it is very difficult due to pungency of chili. And there is a dire need to develop an instrument for rapid objective measurement of quality of dried lychee. During the manual analysis, we need to depend on manual beings and depend on the authenticity of the result by the manual analysis. But in the system analysis, machine-machine solution analysis, as it is a system-based analysis, results is given. It is more authentic and more repeatable than and reliable than a manual analysis. So this is the conveyorized vision inspection unit that we have developed. And research challenges were there, the spreading of chili samples. Chili samples, the stalks are connected to each other, the pot length are irregular. So this is the challenge. So there is a challenge to spread the chili sample. How can we spread the chili sample on a conveyor? We need to do a rapid analysis. 1 kg chili samples need to be checked. 1 kg chili samples, merely 1,200 or 1,500 numbers of chilies. Now, user interface should be very easy for operation because the ground people, they may not be, they may have a small computer literacy, so they can easily use our software. To avoid the chili sample in case of double counting during online image analysis, we have to develop an algorithm to avoid the double counting of the chili samples. Image analysis algorithm, analysis of different quality parameters of chili, length, identification of chili with stalk, pot length, chili sample without stalk, discolored chili, damaged chili, etc. And there is a seamless integration so that data can be directly uploaded after analysis to the INAM portal. And we have developed a modular design so that it can be taken to the industry, because the size of the system is not like another one's dynamic system. It's more or less 10 feet long, the system. Basic unit of the particular system is on conveyorized and a conveyor and hopper with mechanical feed arrangement, a specially designed vibratory discharge unit that breaks the lump and separate each chili samples. There is some notch and different size we have made as a mechanical arrangement. The vision inspection unit built with a camera and uniform illumination arrangement, and the computer-based automated image analysis solutions we have developed. The instant analysis of appearance-based quality parameter of chili, automated stop arrangement we have made using the same principle as I told earlier. If you find the 3 consecutive frames without any chili sample, it gives a command to the system to stop it automatically. Then analysis time, it takes only 5 minutes to process to analyze 1 kg of dry red chili sample. Now the principal operation is simple like that. We have divided the total conveyor in few frames, putting some white marker on it Main idea is that image is taking continuously. Here we are not stopping the conveyor. We are taking image continuously while the chili sample is moving on the conveyor. But when the in a particular image, when the image find two particular white strips, then these particular frames passed for further analysis. Otherwise, it will not pass for this analysis. So this is the way how we have avoid the double counting of chili samples and duplication of frame analysis. So this is an image analysis block diagram. We have the simple, the different algorithm we have applied for analysis of chili sample. But challenge is that the pot length calculation, it is not just point to point straight line calculation, it is curved. So we have developed a particular algorithm for development is curved line calculation for that. And this is the city view system, the software screenshot. Now I'm showing the video representation of the developed solutions. In a particular hopper, we have to take the 1 kg of chili sample, or here I am showing the few samples. Automatic wet calculation is there. This is a vibratory hopper with different type of arrangement. We are made separate the chili samples. Chili sample pass onto the vibratory hopper. It gets separated when it falls to the conveyor belt. And it goes. The visual inspection unit captures each frame and performs the analysis. Now the performance analysis, chili sample we have taken for 1 kg quantity. Sorry, I have told you it's 1,300. No, the quantity is more or less average of 2,200 number of chili sample in 1 kg. Sorry for that. So manual inspection time takes 20 to 30 minutes and machine inspection time is roughly around 5 minutes. And accuracy, we have calculated our results with the human analysis results and we found the result matched with the accuracy of 95%. And the system is up and running in different places in Karnataka, in Tamil Nadu, and Andhra Pradesh. And finally, we have developed another solution for the disease detection of Tasson moth using micrographic image analysis solution. And this particular disease is called the Pebrin. It is a disease caused by a parasite. Microsporidian parasite named Nosema bombacis. The disease spreads transverally, means through egg, it's spread from mother to moth to the next generation. And if any stage like larvae or pupa or moths, this can be affected with the pathogen. And once the disease has been detected, we need to kill the entire larvae or pupa. We do not have any remedy for kill this disease. So we have to destroy the whole eggs or the larvae or pupa of that found the single moth with that particular disease. Now, the presently, the sample slide has been prepared. The same methodology we adapted. We have not changed the manual procedure of sample preparation, only the photomicrographic analysis or microscopic image analysis technique, we have augmented with our developed software, where we have put a symbol. This is a microscope and the camera. We have used to put the camera on the eyepiece of it and the specification of the microscope, the similar student microscope. It's cost around the 3,000 to 5,000. And the web camera we've used for capture image. And the student microscope, the below portion, we have put one LED light so that we can run the software throughout the day. And this is the Pebrin spore looks like when we take the image. These are the spores. You can see the rice grain type small portion in the image. And basic characterization feature is basically shape. It is oval or ovocylindrical, and the size is 1.5 to 2 micron to 3 to 5 microns. And size of area, length, breadth, and elongation ratio is the characterizing feature. And another feature very important is the shininess and brightness. So with that of using that features, we can able to detect the presence of spore in the image. Now, this is the different algorithm and software modules we have used for detection of the pebbling spore, and features is basically same thing, the area, perimeter, length of major axis, length of minor axis, ratio of minor and this major and minor axis, compactness ratio. Using these features, we can able to detect the particular presence of spores in the image. So in the image, after image enhancement, they actually, we are taking the image. This is look like in the left side, you can see the image. After processing, we have this type of image, and this is very easy for us to detect the pebbling spore in the image after processing. And you can see in the image with the red box, the pebbling spore has been perfectly detected by the solutions. And also during the field trial, we found that there is a lot of noise because of presence of various types of fat bodies and others. And we have eliminating this fat body using applying this image processing algorithms, but it is not always giving the results of 100%. And we demand that it is correct around this results is 95 to 98% for disease detection purpose. Now, these solutions we have developed, this is working in various silk moth industries. The technology has been transferred. In the concluding slide, I have shared my idea, how we have developed the electronic vision system and different applications I have shared with you. The detection of endpoint of fermentation, tea testing, tea gradation, blackness, and fiber estimation. The another one smart and another one dynamic system. This for the quality analysis of rice and pulses. City view system, it's a machine vision solution for quality analysis of chili. And finally, the pebbling spore solution, pebrinoscope, that is a microscopic image analysis solution for identification of pebbling disease in a silk moth. With that, I like to stop here. Thank you for patience listening. Any question, please? Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir. Thank you,
sir. Any questions?
Sir, we can find out that there are a few questions from the participant. And we request to all participants that if you have any question, please post it in the chat box or in the question answer section. Sir, can you find the question answer, sir?
Yes. So first question is, can you explain the histogram intersection a little bit? Yes. Just wait, because due to limitation of time, I skipped that slide, but please, I'm just explaining that one.
Sir, you may reshare it so that it can be visible, sir.
It can't share that one. Just a minute.
Actually, it has been closed, sir.
Okay. Just a minute. Just a minute. Can you see this one?
Yes, sir, it is now visible, sir.
Okay. Take an example of this one. We have an image of rabbit, okay? So for this time being, you consider it has 10 number of particular colors. And we are finding the blue color, we have 10 pixels. Green color, we have no pixels. Then pink color, we have zero like that. The red color, we have 10 pixels like that. Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Shall I continue?
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Okay, so if you plot the different color in the
Sir, your voice is not coming, sir.
X-axis and the y-axis. So in histogram, it's a particular vector that represent like this, 0, 10, 0, 10, 0, 0, 100, 10, 30, 0, 0. Like this. We are now coming to that. We need another image, that is the image of tortoise. We need to compare the image of rabbit to the tortoise image. Now we have another image, the rabbit image, but the image you have taken the mirrored image we have taken for the rabbit. Now we have to compare this image, the rabbit image, with the tortoise image and mirrored image of rabbit. Ideally, this rabbit image with the mirrored rabbit image should be same. The image of tortoise and the rabbit will be different, right? So you just close the left side portion of the image. Now we have data, the histogram data of that one. In the color distribution of rabbit, we have 10, 0, 0, 100, 10, 30, 0, 0. In the tortoise, we have a color vector of 0, 40, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 100, 10, 0. We consider these are the colors for this particular example. And the color distribution of this rabbit is also like 10, 90, 10, 40, like this. Now, there is some color variation, maybe due to this mirroring the image of rabbit. So there is a difference in some color values. So here, first one is 100, here it's 90, like that. Now, we have to find out the matching of two image by seeing the color values. So we have only these color values in the computer database or computer memory. We have to analyze these values to find out which two images are same, which images are different. Now I told the histogram intersection, it is a minimum of two histogram values in the two vectors of line. Now you see the first one and second. You compare the position of first one. 10, the second image is 0. So minimum is 0, right? Now the second position, the 0 and second position is 40. So minimum is 0. Like that, you compare the each locations of two images. Location wise, compare the two images and find the minimum value. So after finding the value, you add the total value. And this is called the similarity. If we find the minimum value between the two images, the tortoise and first rabbit images, we'll find the summation value of similarity is 0. Now we compare the first image to the last image. Now compare the location first, 10. And the last image location is 10. The second location is 0, 0, like that. From 190, the minimum value is 90. So we'll put 90 here. Then next location, 10, 10, minimum value is 10. Then 30 and last image, 40, the location, same location, we'll find 30 and 40. So minimum is 30, look likes. And we add the all value and find the value, that is similarity value is 140. Now the thumb rule is that the big intersection of high value of similarity gives the large or the two image that are more or less same. So with that, calculating the similarity index, we can able to tell whether the two images are same. In particular, we have defined a threshold value for similarity calculation in our particular case of hue histogram color matching. So I think I have clarified. Hello? Hello?
Hello? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's clear, sir.
So the next question. What is the next question?
Sir, next question is from Sikha Das. Which algorithm is better for background segmentation of multiple objects?
Okay, so I cannot tell a single algorithm for telling the background segmentation of the multiple object. It depends upon the type of the object and background. Usually, there are two types of algorithm, the global thresholding you can do, but in global threshold, there should be a fixed value of threshold that apply to the throughout the image. But that is in practical image, that should not be happen. But if there is a large difference with the background to the object, you can use the global threshold value. In particular, the dimension analysis of T-sample, as T-sample is black and we have the white background, so it's very easy for us to put a threshold value and apply this threshold value to the whole image for we have used for the global threshold value for that one. And for that, finding the global threshold value, we have used the OSTU measure. But in case of practical image, we find that image distribution of object color or distribution of illumination is not same throughout the image. So we use the local threshold value, that is the small threshold value has been defined for a particular block, and we apply throughout the image. So local thresholding technique can be used. So the single algorithm, we cannot tell, but we have to work, we have to test it and find out the suitable algorithm for that. Next. Next question. Hello?
Yes, sir. Sir, next question is how to measure the quality of multiple vegetable and fruits using one classification model?
I couldn't get your last few words because I was I am not able to hear you. What is the question?
To measure the quality of multiple vegetables and fruit using one classification model?
The single classification problem doesn't work for all type of vegetables analysis. It depends upon type of vegetables. Say, for example, during the analysis of tomato and capsicum, single heart classification technique we have used for that one. So it depends upon what type of vegetables you are going to analyze, the object color and the distribution of the object, how it's different, what is the relation with the quality with the change of color. So single classification algorithm cannot be used in all cases. Next.
Sir, next question is from Praveer Mandal Singh. What is the camera setup for capturing macroscopic purbine spores?
Camera setup?
Yes, sir. What type of camera like that, sir?
Are you talking about the configuration parameter of camera?
So actually the question is what is the camera setup? Camera setup for capturing.
Camera setup. Okay. During my presentation, I have shown that we have the camera lens axis is quenchite with the objective of the eyepiece. It is very difficult to align the axial match with the camera to the objective. So this is a special mechanical design we have built in our lab where the three screw type adjustment we have to make for that one. Next question. Hello.
Yes, sir. Next question is from Sir Sikha Das. How to extract the color feature of any object?
Hello, sir. Basically, yes, the color features an object. Basically, different type of color model you can use to identify or to extract the color values of each pixels. Now, from the each color value, you have to define your own features. For example, you can take the average value by calculating the whole pixels from the whole pixels value. So mean value is a feature. Then you can find out the standard deviation of distribution of color. This may be a feature. So from the color pixel value, you can develop your own features. You can extract your own features. So statistical features may be there, or different type of extraction technique you can use. There are a lot of extraction technique is available. You can find it, all those things in literature survey, you will get the how to do the feature extractions. Next.
Yes, are there any more questions, Prem? I have just joined.
Last question is there.
I'm not aware.
Subhradeep Rang, is rice grain separation done manually in the sample tray?
That is a very good question. During the sample tray, I told you that we have developed a special mechanical arrangement that is a perforated tray. So this perforated tray is having a particular groups with a certain distance. And this perforated, we have to put manually sample on the perforated tray. And after checking the sample, we have to take out the plate from the actually sample holder, and we'll find the rice grains is uniformly spread. So this is a tricky thing, this mechanical arrangement we have to develop for spreading of rice grain. Next question.
Sir, these were the questions from the participants. Ma'am, all the questions have been answered.
It's 12:25, maybe.
Ma'am, your voice is not audible. Ma'am.
Ma'am, your voice is not audible.
Is it audible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, yes, ma'am. It is loud and clear.
Okay. It's already 12:25. I think we can close this session. Yes. In between, I had to go away for another meeting, so I could not hear the entire presentation. But I'm sure it must have been a very good presentation. And the participants would have benefited from it. So on behalf of all of us, we would like to thank Mr. Amitabho for being with us and sparing time to be with us. And if there are any further questions, the participants can write in the discussion forum and they can be answered by the experts.
Thank you, madam, for giving me opportunity to speak, and thank you.
We cannot see you actually. Okay. Your video is off.
Actually, I made it off because of bandwidth problem. Otherwise,
okay.
I think you can see me. Okay, thank you, ma'am, for, I think we can start a good collaborative research with MacOut. It is a beginning. And I look forward to have a good research, collaborative research in future. Thank you, ma'am.
Not only with AI, there are so many image processing applications also in the field of agriculture. So yes, there are a number of areas in which CDAC and MacOut can collaborate.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
That will
thank
be really good.
For the presentation.
Thank you very much. So, so I think we can start the second deliberation. We have what is a question? Just a moment. Someone had Probir Mondol. Please bring.
Ma'am, we are looking over it, sir. We are taking care of it, ma'am.
At the second session, we have Mrs. Munmun Chakraborty with us. Welcome to this workshop. So she will be deliberating on deep learning. So before I request her to start her deliberation, I would like to give a brief introduction. Mrs. Munmun Chakraborty is currently working as principal engineer of CDAC, Kolkata. Her research interest is in the areas of image processing and computer vision. It furthered with application in artificial intelligence and machine learning technique. During the recent past, she has been assigned in the quantum computing group as a part of CDAC quantum computing mission. I request Mrs. Chakraborty to please start her deliberation.
Hello, good afternoon. I have shared my screen. Is it visible?
Yes, yes, it's visible.
So I will start with AIML, deep machine learning, and deep learning. Sorry. Yeah. So we have a confusion that what is artificial intelligence, then machine learning, and deep learning. So I will start with artificial intelligence. When a machine is able to mimic the human intelligence by having ability to predict, classify, learn, and or perceive. So machine learning is a subset of artificial intelligence. And deep learning is a subset of machine learning. So finally, deep learning is a subset of machine learning that uses neural network to solve some more complex challenges such as image, audio, video classification. I will start with a quote of Herbert Alexander Simon. Learning is any process by which a system improves performance from experience. Machine learning is concerned with computer program that automatically improve their performance through experience. So traditional programming was in the computer, the input was data and program, and we get some output. Whereas in machine learning, our input is data as well as output. So the model tried to learn some pattern underlying the data, and it generates some output, which is not exactly same as the output given to the model. So there is an error. The model tried to minimize that error between the output Y and predicted Y. And in this learning loop, finally, it got some experience and it can predict some unknown query given to it. In the traditional programming, I have to give a value of x, and I have to write a function between the output y and x. So the machine gives me the output. Like if I give the rule as y equal to double of x, then it will generate an output. Whereas in the machine learning, I will give the data as well as the answer, and the model will generate the rule base, the relationship between the x and y. So what is machine learning? Suppose I am standing in front of a garbage bin, and I will try to put a garbage paper into the bin. First, I will throw it. It will not drop exactly to the dustbin. So second time, what I will try? I will try to make my angle more close to the box. I will come closer to it. So after several iteration and experience, finally, I will be able to drop it to the bin. A more formal definition, if my model want to recognize handwritten characters, handwritten digits. So what I will do? I will make a rule base for each and every digit. First, I will start with zero. When I will make a rule that it should contain a circle within it, then it may be confused. If the model get confused with 9, which other have circle on it. So as the learning grow, it will, the rule base will be elaborated and complicated. Instead, if I give the model thousands of examples and let the model to learn by itself instead of my rule base, it will be the model will devise a rule base for each of the character, and when a new character will come, it will be able to recognize the digit. So a formal definition of machine learning is, a machine learning algorithm is an algorithm that is able to learn from data. So what do we mean by that? A computer program is said to learn from experience E with respect to some class of task T and performance measure P if its performance at task T as measured by P improves with experience E. Let's have some simpler version. When I am throwing the paper, garbage paper, into the dustbin, so my task is to drop the paper into the dustbin. And my experience is, first time it is not, the paper not dropped to the bin. So I have to make the angle between my arms more closer. I have to come closer to the dustbin. This is my experience. And by this experience, I try to improve my performance. In our example of handwritten character digits, the task is to recognize the handwritten characters. The experience E refers to the example of handwritten digits, and the performance measure P is the accuracy with which the computer can recognize a digit. Two important features of machine learning. The machine learning, it tries to discover the pattern underlying into the data. It is also called as inference. It try to make prediction about the future based on data about the past. Somehow it is called generalization, which I will come later. There are several types of machine learning, popularly supervised, unsupervised. Then other areas of machine learning are semi-supervised, reinforcement learning, etc. First, start with supervised learning. Supervised learning is when the model is getting trained on a labeled data set. That is, I have a data set X and I will label it like I have a set of balls. I will color it like green ball, blue ball, white ball, like that. So when a new ball will come, it can be classified based on its color, the color of the ball. So this is a learning, supervised learning problem. There are two types of supervised learning, classification and regression. First, classification. Here, I have a set of data. It is set of data. The input is gender, age, and salary. The customer, actually, this is a chart for a particular product, whether it will be purchased by a customer or not, based on gender, age, and salary. So I will learn the model, this data, and finally, it can be able, and I will label it 0 and 1. That is, for first column, I will label it 0. For second, not column, for second row, I will label it 1. Like this, I will label each of the input with 0 and 1. Finally, when a new entry will come, it will be, after the learning is over, it will be able to classify a new customer whether it will purchase or not. Regression is the type of when we have continuous value. Let's take an example. This is a meteorological data set. Here, the input is pressure, relative humidity, wind direction, and the output is wind speed. So what is the difference? The difference is classification problem. I have output as a class. That is, if I have two class problem, when an input will come, I have to classify that input whether it will be good or bad. Whereas in the regression problem, my input is some values and I have to give output as a number. So this is the classification and regression problem. This is now unsupervised learning. When I have large data set, which is not leveled, it is not possible for me to level each of the data, huge unstructured data. So, but I have to learn the model with my data. That is called unsupervised learning. There are several types of it, like clustering, anomaly detection, association, dimensional reduction, etc. Clustering. I have unstructured data, but there are some pattern among them by which I can classify it by several class. That is called clustering, clustering problem. Like I have a set of bag of balls, but there are some pattern in it, like color or something different, by which property the model can cluster the data into three cluster. Then dimensionality reduction problem. It is a learning model by which after reduction of data, the model can reduce the data set, still it can encode some important feature in it. And a popular example is PCA. For our case in face recognition, suppose I have given the model 5% each of having 100 of faces, each person having 100 of faces. So, and I mix all these faces, I fit to the learning model. Finally, what it will give my output? It will give me an eigenface. That is a reduced feature vector, which has all the important property of that 5 into 100, 500 faces. All those important features are within these eigenface feature vector. Association rules are perfect for examples such where I want to find related item. A common example is Amazon. When we want to purchase an item like mobile, I visit the Amazon app, I will select a mobile and I will keep it to the basket. What it will see in the below bar, it will show similar type of items. So how it can do? Amazon use association rule to able to find out similar items based on your choice. Then anomaly detection, it is used in fraud detection in bank. Like when I go to bank, I do some transactions, I maintain a same pattern in my transaction. But when I do some abnormal behavior, the bank system tries to find out, is there any fraud attempt made? So this is anomaly detection. So this is the main classification, supervised, unsupervised. Supervised discrete is classification, supervised continuous is regression, unsupervised discrete is clustering, unsupervised continuous is dimensionality reduction. Another learning method is semi-supervised, which is mix of two. I have a huge data bank, which is not possible to label for me. So what I can do? I will take a small part of it. I will label that and I will mix it to the whole data bank. The model will try to make the learning based on the small amount labeled data set. It will try to label the unlabeled data set, and finally it will be learned. A popular example of semi-supervised learning is generative adversarial network, which is called as GAN network. Mainly it has two type of neural network, generator and discriminator. Generator try to make fake data based on the small amount of labeled data set. It tries to make fake data, and the discriminator part try to make the prediction whether a input, real image input, it is real or fake. This is the two main part of GAN, generator and discriminator. Another learning model is reinforcement learning. It is based on reward. Like when it is a type of, when I try to learn a dog, what we do? We give the dog some prize, that is a bone or dog treat, when it will do some good performance. And based on that dog try to train by himself. So the process is the agents observe input, agents perform an action by making some decision. After its performance, agents receive reward and accordingly reinforce the model stores the state action pair of the information. Usually this type of learning is done in video game. AlphaGo, this is a popular Go game. Google DeepMind, these are popular items where reinforcement learning is used. So this is in a nutshell, what is the different part of machine learning, supervised, unsupervised, reinforcement learning, like that. There are several terminology like data. What is data? Data may be text, may be image, may be sound, different things. When the most important part of all data is, this is the most important part in machine learning. Without data, we cannot train any model. When the data is interpreted and well manipulated, it is converted to information. Finally, with learning, it transformed to knowledge. And what is model? I was telling about model, learning model. What is model? The representation of a phenomena that a machine learning algorithm has learned. It learned this representation from input and output. Finally, the model is produced. So this important thing, that data, how we can use in machine learning. Suppose I have 100 input data. I will split it in several parts: training data, validation data, and testing data. I will take 60% of data as my training data. I will keep 20% for validation of my training. And final 10% I will use for testing my model, whether it has some error or not. At the time of testing, so finally, when the model got learned after using that 100 of data, when I will give the model previously unseen new input, it has to classify, has to cluster anything. So the model has to make some performance on new unseen data. So if it will first, it will make some error. If the error is based on training data, we will call as training error. If the error is done at the time of testing, we will call as test error. So our objective is make the error as minimum as possible. Two central challenge of machine learning is underfitting and overfitting. This is the generalization problem. Whether a new thing will be recognized or not, well, based on the input previously learned. Two main challenges is underfitting and overfitting. If my data size is very low, on which the model is unable to extract some feature, unable to learn something, it is called underfitting. This thing can be avoided if I make some more data into my model. If I enlarge my data set, this type of error or challenge can be mitigated. Another was in overfitting. This is more problematic. If I have lots of data, the model grade trained so much that it tried to learn from noise or data which is not well related with the model I want to infer. So this is called overfitting. It is start to learn from noise. It is called overfitting. So there are several methods how to avoid overfitting. That is cross-validation. Cross-validation is a standard way to find out the prediction error. This is a careful cross-validation. I can make you understand. Suppose I am taking as five-fold cross-validation. I have a data set of 100 samples and I will try to try this five-fold cross-validation. What I will do, I will take five subgroups out of 100 data set. So I have five subgroups. At the training time, I will take five iteration. For first iteration, I will take group 1, 2, 3, 4, and group 5 I will use for test. Second iteration, I will take group 1, 3, 4, 5, and group 2 I will leave for test. Third iteration, I will take 1, 2, 4, 5, and I will take group 3 as testing, like that. So each time when I will do testing, I will get some error. Finally, when I will total the error for 5 iteration and I will do the average, then I will get the final performance. This is cross-validation. Early stopping, when it is a experience-based model, I have to make a rule that will provide me when I have to stop the learning. When it will start to learn from noise, I have to stop it. This is early stopping. Pruning is another method. And finally, regularization. I will give some example later. So introduction to neural network. This is the era when machine learning is a glorified area in machine learning. When McCulloch Pates proposed the a perceptron which tries to simulate biological neurons. The first computational model of a neuron was proposed by McCulloch and Pates in 1943. It is like biological neurons. When I will get some input x1, x2, like that, my model has mainly two parts, G and A. G is the aggregator part. That is, what it does, it just sum up the inputs. And F part is the activation part, whether the neuron will fire it or not. This is the activation part. based on some threshold. So this is the OR function. You all aware of this truth table. 0 0 0 0 1 1 1 0 1 1 1 1. So if I want to separate this data, I want to classify this data or clustering this data, it can be done by a single line. Single straight line can separate this data. See, if I put a threshold of 0.5, I can draw this line which can separate two classes. Similarly, I am taking a truth table of AND function. I will plot here. Here also a single line can separate these two classes. A simple threshold is able to separate these two classes. AND NOT gate, same, it can also separate it by a single line. But where this perceptron things got stuck when it tried to separate the data obtained from XOR function. XOR function, see, 0 0 0 0 1 1 1 0 1 1 1 0. Maculloch-Pitts model is unable to separate this data within a single perceptron. Here, three perceptron is needed. Combination of OR and NOT gate. See, I have two. This is a node. The input is X1 and X2. And I will make OR on it. This is another node. I will make AND on it. Finally, I will do AND or NOT, and I can able to get the output. So this is the explanation why and not why. Why and not why, I will take this in bracket. This is can be written as the Y2 bar. So this Y1 can be substituted as X1 or X2. Y2 can be substituted as X1 and X2. So after this, finally, I will get X1 XOR X2. So this is the introduction of multilayer perceptron. So instead of single perceptron, when the data is nonlinear type, single perceptron is not able to cluster them. So then we need multilayer perceptron. The idea is I have an input, I have hidden layer, and finally some processing is done here. Finally, I get the output. Neural networks are trained iteratively using optimization techniques like gradient descent. After each cycle of training, an error metric is calculated based on difference between prediction and target. The derivative of this error matrix are calculated and propagated back through the network using a technique called backpropagation. Each neuron's coefficients or weights are then adjusted relative to how much they contributed to the total error. This process is repeated iteratively until the network error drops below an accepted threshold. That is the threshold when I will stop the learning. So I have told you some terminology here like gradient descent, then backpropagation. I am coming to that. First, cost. If I want to tell something on gradient descent, I have to clarify that cost function. What is cost function? I have told you in my first slide that I have an output and I have a predicted output and I have a error between that. My objective is to minimize that error. This is the cost function. The cost function is a measure to evaluate the performance of a model. It is used to compute the error of the output layer during backpropagation. Then what is gradient descent? it is a method to minimize this cost function or minimize the error. The aim is to find the local global minima of a function. In the mathematical statement, it can optimize the convex function. Now I am coming to that. Suppose I will start, I will take a random, this is a single variate model. I will start with a random theta and I will take how I can calculate the gradient. This is del f del theta del theta. So each after each iteration, I will calculate this expression and update my theta. N is the learning rate. If N is very high, after reaching global minima, it will accelerate. So taking the learning rate is very important thing in this type of learning. So if I take two variate, what is two variate? What is single variate? Suppose in my model, in the input, I have a single column. I have a single column input, like ball. I have only color as my feature. This is single variate. If I take two feature vector, it will call multivariate or bivariate. If instead of two feature vector, I will take like fish, I will take the shape, I will take the color, I will take the type of whether it has bone or not, like that three feature vector, then it is multivariate. So in my problem, from the input node, I will initialize some weight on that. So my here theta, for theta, my theta is the weight vector. And my cost function is the y. This is the g part. That is, I have told you the aggregation of it, the x1, x2, x3 with some weight and some adding some bias. This is my predicted y, and I will calculate the error between two. After calculating this, I will do derivative with respect to derivative of this cost function with respect to weight. And I will update my weight after each iteration. So my, what is backpropagation? So I am calculating this each iteration. And how I will update my weight? I can update my weight by backpropagation. It minimizes the cost function and increase the performance of the network model. Backpropagate the error and update the weight to reduce the error. This is the model. X1, X2 is my input. H1, H2 is my, this is my hidden layer and this is my output layer. I will start with some weight W1, W2 and bias B1. So my what will be the cost function? W1 X1 plus W2 X2 plus B1. This is the input to this node. Same for this node H2, X1, X1, W2, X2, W4 and B1. So this is, this node will be calculated. So after that, it will face some activation function and give some output. This is the output. This is the output layer. Same calculation as the hidden layer will be done here. And finally, we will get some output. So first, I will calculate in this layer. In this direction, this is called forward propagation. That is, I will calculate this, I will add this, I will make some decision here, then I propagate in this way, forward pass. Finally, when I will get the output, it will not exactly same as the input. So what I will do, then I will back propagate the thing in each layer. This is called as back propagation. So I got introduced with perceptron, then multilayer perceptron, and then I am coming to deep learning, which is multilayer perceptron with multiple layers, deep layers. This is deep learning. deep learning is a kind of multi-layer perceptron which held together as a network. The deep learning is a form of multi-layer perceptron with more layer, deeper network. The multi-layer perceptron was first introduced in 50s to computationally evaluate human brain. As I told you that McCulloch Pease tried to simulate human brain with perceptron, but human brain has to learn complex structure, which is not possible by a single perceptron, as complicated structures are there, non-linear patterns are there. So multi-layer perceptron, and finally, again, deep layers required for that. So this neural deep learning network came into the picture. Going through second of artificial intelligence trend in 80s, with introduction of backpropagation, deep learning became famous in ImageNet in 2012 as deep convolutional network. So looking through the history, multilayer perceptron can be said that it is the origin of deep learning. Deep neural networks have multiple hidden layers, and they can learn very complicated relationships between input and output. What is the problem with deep learning network? See, in deep learning network, there is multiple layers, and multiple layers has to face multiple parameters like multiple weights. So what it will face? It has to face overfitting. How to overcome that overfitting? Their regularization come into the picture. Regularization is technique used to avoid the overfitting problem. There are many types of regularization methods. One is L2 parameter or weight decay. Here, lambda one, I introduce this term. First, I have the cost function, yj, and this is the weight and x aggregation. This is the predicted weight, and this is my output weight. This is my cost function, as previously seen. Now, I added this regularizer. This lambda is called regularizer, and this is my beta. What is beta? My weights. This will regularize the overfitting problem. This is the L2 parameter regularization or ridge regression, ridge regularization. Another one is L1 parameter regularization or lasso regularization. See, here I have used beta square. Instead of that, here beta 1 is taken, mod of beta 1. Beta is, in our case, beta is the weight, W. Another very popular or research work method is dropout. Dropout can be seen as a method which combine an average large number of network model without individual training. Suppose I have a model. If I learn the model through a network, it will get some learning. Instead of a single learning, if I am able to give him multiple of learning network, then his knowledge will be better. So it is called ensemble learning. Every time, instead of single learning, multiple learning is always good. Multiple, but it is not very much luxurious for us who has very limited data. If I segregate my data to give the model with different type of learning, then it will then go for underfitting. The data will be very less for each of training network. But here dropout can do this thing. How? I am telling that. Model combination nearly always improves the performance of machine learning method. In order to make neural net model different, it has two different architecture trained on it. Dropout is a technique that addresses both these issues. since we here what we do, we will drop some neurons for each iteration randomly with probability 0.5. That is, it will be or it will not be. With some random 0.5 probability, we will drop some of the neurons each layer randomly. So each layer I will get a new network if I have in a layer I have 5 neurons, 5 nodes randomly. If I off it, I have told you that cross validation, I will randomly off some node. So every time it will be a new network. So if I have 5 neurons, I will get 2^5 that amount of thin network every time. Applying dropout to a neural network amounts to sampling a thin network from it. That is, I am thinning network every time dropping some neurons. A neural net with n units can be seen as a collection of 2^n possible thinned neural network. If I have thin node in each layer, I can get 2^8 possible of thin neural network every time. That is, previously I was able to feed my network with a single network having 3 nodes. Now it is possible for me to train my model with 8 thin neural networks. It is good. Suppose I have taken a very simple with a single hidden layer a neural network model. I will drop these 3, so it will be a new network, new thin network. We are for H is the hidden layer. We are randomly sampling from 2^8 different architecture. If I have H hidden layers, all architecture share weights. The sharing of weights means every model is very strongly regularized. It is better than L1 or L2 regularization. This is a standard neural network, and this is after applying dropout. Comparison with other standard regularizer, it has shown that dropout given better result than others. I have used MNIST database, and for my work, I have my training data size was 50,000 and validation data was 10,000. I have taken my test data size as 10,000. That is, I have splitted my data like this. So this is the graph without drop model with and without dropout model. This is a standard MNIST database. This is shown by Hinton. The different color as shown here, these are different data set. This is the Hinton. This is the accuracy graph shown by Hinton, who is the proposer of dropout algorithm. This is test error with and without dropout with different data set. Here red is a data set. Here red is the data set with dropout and without dropout. And here it is the epoch. How much iteration I have made? How far I learned my model. So where I can use deep learning classification? Yes, I can use that in image search. Google is using, Bing, Baidu, all are using. In detection purpose, still it is not used. Still traditional biologist method is used till now. Then several object detection, it is also deep learning is getting used. This is the CNN. There are different type of deep learning neural network, like convolutional neural network, RNN neural, recurrent neural network, then Boltzmann machine, then recursive neural network. There are several type of neural network. Among them, I have already used this CNN, convolutional neural network. So I am going through it. In CNN, there are different layers, like convolutional layers, pooling layers, normalization layers, like that. Then finally, fully connected layer, etc. Start with convolutional network. The layer, this perform a convolutional operation, creating several smaller picture windows to go over the data. ReLU, this is the nonlinearity activation layer, which converts all the negative pixel to zero. This gives the output as a rectified feature map. Pooling layer, is a downsampling operation that reduces the dimensionality of the feature map. Fully connected layer recognizes and classifies the objects in an image. Start with convolution. What is convolution? I have a picture. I have a picture with 3 by 3 picture, and I have a filter. I have a filter with 2 by 2 resolution. What I will do? First, I will start with 0, 0. I will do the inner product between the pixel value and the filter value. I will get some output. Then I will shift it. I will, for first inner product, then sum, I will get a result for the first pixel. Then I will shift it. For the after shifting, I will do the same process. Inner product, then sum. I will get the next value. I will down it, shift to the downwards. I will, same thing, inner product, sum. I will get the output. Then I will take it the last position, and same thing, I will get some output. So after convolution, I get a reduced size of output. Suppose this is my image. Image size is 32 by 32, and 3 is the depth, that is RGB value, channel 3. If I take a grayscale image, it will be 3 by 2 by 1 image. And in the filter, I have 5 by 5 into 3, same for 3 channels filter. So if I do the convolution, shifting or striding throughout the image, it will give me output of a 22 by 22 into 1 grayscale value. I will get output as the convoluted image. So if I take 6 of that filter, I will get 6 of this convoluted image. So here the depth is 6 for 6 filter. I am stacking this 28 by 28 into 6 stacked feature map. I will call as feature map after using the convolution and ReLU activation function. I will get the feature map. This is the convolution, and after, this is my one feature. This is the flow chart. First input image, then I will do the convolution and nonlinearity. I will get the feature map. After this image, output this image. Then each hidden unit is connected to a subregion. I am convoluting each part. If I do the convolution like this part, I will take a neuron and I will connect it all over this, all part of this part. Then it will make some confusion, like the pattern of the eyes or beaks is not same as the tail. So it is required to take locally connected layer. So I am taking small size of filter and I will make the convolution. I will take different size also. That is 3 by 3, 5 by 5, 7 by 7, different a stack of filter bank. And I will make the convolution to get locally connected data. If my image is 32 by 32 and I will take the filter as 32 by 32, it will be connected all over the pixel value and some redundant information will be generated. Instead, I will take locally connected values. Then I will go to pooling. pooling is downsampling. Most common approach pooling is max pooling. Look the yellow part. Here for 4 pixel value, I will take the maximum one, 6. This is called max pooling. For the green part, I will take 8. For the blue part, I will take 3. For the red part, I will take 4. So from this image, I will get pooled image. So pooling layer reduce sensitivity to location of features, invariance to image transformation, and increase compactness to representation. Some popular pooling types is max, average. I can do average of the 4 pixel instead of taking max. I can do average like 1 plus 1, 2 plus 6, 8 plus 5, 13. And I will take average value of this 4. This will be max average. That this will take average pooling. Average pooling. Then next layer is normalization. What? I have an image. I need similar response from all part of the image. So what I will do? I will do normalization. It is an approach which is applied during preparation of data in order to change the values of the numeric column in data set to a common scale when the feature of the data having different ranges. There are different type of normalization like batch normalization, weight normalization, layer normalization like that. Finally, I will get the feature map, then I will do the fully connected layer. After feature map, I will do this fully connected layer. Now I have high level features which I have extracted from this input image after several processing, that is ReLU, max pooling, normalization. After several processing, now I have a high level feature values. Now I can connect each of them with other because now these are all relevant features for this image. Now I will do a fully connected multi-layer perceptron I will use. This layer basically takes high level features as input and output n-dimensional feature in n-dimensional vector where n is the number of classes. For example, if I have to classify the 10 digit numbers, for me the class will be n. The class number n will be 10. Basically, fully connected layer looks at what high level feature most strongly correlated with a particular class. Suppose, for example, if the resulting vector is a digit classification problem and for the 10 digit, I have probability values like 0.1, 0.1, 0.75, 0, 0, 0, 0, and 0.5, it represent then 10% for 0, it don't have any probability value. That is, the feature vector is not strongly matched with, not poorly matched also with 0. For 1, it is 10% of probability, that is, it can be matched. Among them, the most matched with image of 3, that is 75% probability. So, the output of this layer is a probability vector. Softmax, this is a, these are some activation function, ReLU and softmax. ReLU is used in the hidden layers after the convolution layer. Softmax is used after the fully connected layer for classification. These are some activation functions. These are also used. This is a case study of, this is AlexNet. Very popular deep neural network, convolutional neural network architecture, which is implemented in GPU. There are several layers in it. First, it starts with input image, then convolution and pooling in the first layer, then second layer also convolution. Actually, different architecture, they are different based on how it is organized or arranged. Same, I can also build my own architecture organizing this layer, convolution or pooling, normalization, this layer in my own way, if I organize, then I will also build my own architecture. This is the AlexNet architecture. This is the deep learning in ImageNet. When I give some inputs in the first few layers, what it will get learned, it will learn the edges of the picture. After several layers in the feature map, what it is learned? It is learned more than some edges. It is learned with patterns, shapes of different facial objects. After more layers, it will get some, it will learn how the face look like if I make it learn with face images. Finally, in the output, I will get the number of classes I want to classify the model. I want to learn the model to classify. This is number of classes. So I will start with the input. First, I have to do the face detection part, eliminating the non-facial region. So I got a bunch of face images. After doing some processing like registration, doing affine transformation like that, I will register the face image, normalizing its pose, color normalization. I will train that through CNN. And finally, I will get a feature vector in the last layer, feature vector. This is my classifier. In the same way, when I got a pair of images, same pre-processing I will do, and I will take this pre-trained model and I will get a feature vector. Finally, I will do some similarity measurement between these two feature vectors. And I will get a binary output whether it is verified or not. This is general structure of a verification model. Some well-known deep learning application in face recognition is DeepFace, what is used in Facebook. Then FaceNet is used by Google. DeepID also very popular type of deep learning, DeepFace. First CNN-based face recognition method by Facebook Research Group. It includes four main steps like detection, 3D alignment, that is registration, feature representation, and classification. For the similarity metric, it used Siamese Energy Neural Network, again a neural network model it used. This is the NIF-DIF model. As I told, started with some face detection, then it goes through several layers, and finally, a classifier or model got trained. DeepID model, it has for convolutional neural network structure, it has four convolutional networks, three max pooling layers, one fully connected layer. For the alignment or registration, it used center two eyes, two corner of the mouse, and nose teeth. These points, they use for alignment or pose normalization. For similarity metric is use joint Bayesian method. VGG model, it is a very popular model. They have given the source code in MATLAB also, this VGG model. Anybody can check that. Inspired by DeepFace network, they develop their own network architecture. They made that publicly available. FaceNet model. This FaceNet model is used by Google Research Group. This is very much popular nowadays. For similarity metric, they use triplet loss. FaceNet is based on two different deep network architecture. One architecture is based on Zeier-Fergus model, consists of a multiple interleaved layer of convolution, nonlinear activation, local response normalization, and max pooling layer. Another architecture is based on inception model. this used mixed layers that run several different convolutional and pooling layers in parallel and concentrate their and concatenate their responses. This is the model structure of FaceNet. This is a deep layer architecture. Finally, as an output, they gave some embeddings, and for similarity measure, they use triplet loss. The model consists of a batch input layer and deep CNN followed by L2 normalization, which results in the face embedding. This is the embedding of each face images. This is the output feature vector embeddings, followed by a triplet loss during training. It is based on learning Euclidean embedding per image using deep convolutional network. This network is trained such as square distance. Actually, this is also another network. They make this network for similarity measure. So this is all about deep learning. Is a nutshell. Research is going on rapidly. So there are many, many things to be discussed on this, but this is in a nutshell where we can start with. This is all about. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your wonderful speech. Sumdutta, ma'am. Hello. Ma'am, there are few questions in the chat box. We can take few questions. The question is, ma'am, first, ma'am, kindly explain what is triplet loss.
Where is this? Okay. Just wait. Yes. How to measure the quality of multiple vegetables and fruits using one classification model?
Ma'am, it was for previous session, ma'am.
Oh. So where is this?
Ma'am, question? The question is from. I can't understand the difference in between original data and clustered data.
Original data and?
Clustered data.
Sorry?
Clustered data.
Tested data.
Clustered data.
Clustered data. Okay. Original data and clustered data.
Yes, ma'am. Ayush Datta has asked, I cannot understand the difference between original data and clustered data.
I have given the example that I have bag of balls. I have bag a 100 balls. This is my original data. I put it in a conveyor belt. The model can make three classes of the data based on its color, red, green, blue. So finally, I got three cluster, red balls, green balls, and blue balls. So my original data is my bag of balls, and my cluster data is the three balls with three different bins. This is my cluster data. Instead of a single bag, I have three bins based on color. This is the difference.
Yes, ma'am. Moving to next question, ma'am. Respected yes. Ma'am, may you kindly explain what is the high bias and high variance in terms of underfitting and overfitting respectively?
May I see the questions actually?
Yes, ma'am. It is in the question answer section. You can close the PPT. At the bottom section, there is Q&A section.
What is high bias and high variance terms underfitting? Have I discussed that thing? Hello?
Ma'am, that is a question actually, normally asked by the question.
Actually, there are many complicated things here. So please confine your question within the discussion. Otherwise, it is not possible within a single stipulated time to answer this type of complicated questions. Underfitting and overfitting is a very complicated mathematical area. So bias, variance, if you can make me understand what is bias and variance, then I can able to make you what is high bias and high variance. Actually, why bias is introduced along input is neural network. It is for averaging. That is, different type of data is there. Bias is a value which can normalize the data. This is the average value to make the data in a, that is 0.5, 0.6, 0.7 different data. I will add a bias one. So all my data will be in a single scale, 1.0, 1.0, like that. It is for averaging the data. Can you please explain the overfitting data? Yes, overfitting is like you your sizes, your dress size is 32 and you are trying a dress size of 36. This is overfitting problem. That is my, for my training of my model, 100 data is enough for me, but my model tries to learn from 1000 of data. Among them, 50, most of the data is not relevant to it. Some of them are noise. So after getting learned from relevant data, it started to learn from noise or irrelevant data. This is actually overfitting. That is, I am trying to take a oversized dress. How it will not look good on me? So it will generate some error. What is meaning by 0.5 drop? 0.5 drop is probability of dropping a particular neuron. That is 5% probability, 0.5. Whether it will one or not, it will be or it will not be. This is probability of, if probability of is one, then all will be, there will not any uncertainty. All of them will be there in the layer. All the neurons will be there. 0.7 probability means I will, among 10, I will drop 3 of them. 7 nodes will be remain. 0.5 means I will make them, any of them, I will make them off. This is the probability how randomly I will drop the neurons. This triplet loss, I am unable to explain here. You can search in the neural network, any internet, because it is a another complicated deep neural architecture what is used by FaceNet for similarity measure. So it is the most important part in the FaceNet. Google is using that. So in this time, it is not possible for me to discuss this triplet dot function. Graphs in the underfitting and overfitting. Actually, they were how I am going to that. This for underfitting, what you I told you, high bias. This is underfitting problem. This is a single layer can classify this thing. This is underfitting problem. I will tell it, some person will tell it in different class because it is not possible to clarify this thing, high bias. But for this thing, I am telling you, I have this.
PPT is not visible, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Please reshare it, ma'am.
Just wait. I have to share screen. Is it visible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. See, I have input. I have data with cross and circle. Two types of data I have. For underfitting, too simple to explain the variance. That is, this is a single layer. This is non-linear type of data. Single layer is not able to classify this thing. So it is underfitting. It is not, underfitting means it is not properly fitting. Most of the data are fitted well. They are clustered well. This is actually appropriate fitting. That is, a nonlinear classifier can appropriately classify this data, that cross and circle. But when it is that model will get overfitted, it will look like this. Look like this. Actually, this is overfitting problem. Too good to be true, but actually it's not true for many cases. Whatever. I think all the questions have been answered.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Question answer session box, there are no more questions.
Okay. So
if anyone wishes to ask anything more, then you can raise your hand. Any question related to this session? Or you can also write in the discussion forum, in the discussion blog link that we have mentioned. There also you can write, and we have shared it with the experts, and they will surely answer.
For the high bias thing, high bias and high variance, I will send some material on it.
Please write your query in the link, in the discussion forum. Okay, so that it can be answered. Yes, so I think we have come to the end of today's session. Thank you very much, Mrs. Moon Chakraborty, for being with us and for sharing your knowledge on deep learning with us.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. We're very grateful to you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
My pleasure, ma'am.
Thank you very much. So we can close the session today, and there is a feedback link given to you. You can give us your feedback, and tomorrow we will meet again at 11 a.m.
Participants, please take note of the feedback link and the joining link. We will be back tomorrow at 11 o'clock. The PPTs and the lecture materials will be very soon emailed to everyone. And for any questions, please post it in the discussion forum.
Yes, it's true that I had forgotten to mention that the presentations are available now, and very soon they will be emailed to all of you. So the presentations of the first 3 days are available, and you will be getting them today. By today itself, we will mail it to you.
Thank you all for participating. We will be back tomorrow at 11 o'clock. Thank you all. Please take the note of the links, feedback link and the joining link. And the PPT, as told by our ma'am, that it will be mailed to everyone. So it will be mailed by today only. So please take the note of the feedback link and the joining link. We will be back tomorrow at 11 o'clock. Thank you. We are closing the session. Thank you all.